There are two most common foundation types in Nordic countries, beam foundation and slab foundation. The difference is that on a beam foundation, the weight of the house is laying on this footing, but on slab foundation, on that whole area. A proper slab foundation gonna cost you more than a proper beam foundation. Nowadays, everyone can draw what they want, and people need the cheapest solution. That is why on the market there are many foundations available looking like a slab but are actually some sort of hybrids. These foundations have many disadvantages which I'm gonna talk about in the next video, but this video is about the beam foundations. Before I start to talk about modern foundations, let's look back how our ancestors built them. They took a deep ditch and filled it with rocks. As a mortar, they used clay or mixture of sand, water and cereal flour. When the water freezes, it expands. The same happens with the ground. Ice has got massive power, it can raise the house. To prevent that, ancestors built foundations below possible freezing point. Depends on the region, but in Estonia somewhere 1.2 to 1.5 meters. Nowadays, people want cheap houses, so deep foundations are becoming rare. They reduce the depth of foundations and add foam insulation on a perimeter. This insulation need to hold back cold from the outside and keep warmth coming from the heated house. These houses need to be heated through all the cold season, otherwise the cold can make some damage. It can also happen while the building process. Since the house is cold, the ice under the foundation raises the house, leading to cracks in the walls. The deeper foundation, the less risk you have. I once dug up about 12 years old EPS foam insulation from the normal ground, and it was wet and weighted many times more than the new one. What happens is that with time EPS absorbs water and by that it loses its features. So I don't believe that they do work in the ground. The visible part of the foundation is named the house plinth. Today people prefer low plinths. They look better, are cheaper and don't need annoying stairs. Ancestors built higher plinths since house walls were usually from logs. Water can damage the wood. The lower wall, the faster it can rot. In summer, raindrops splash from the ground, making the wall wet. And in winter, the snow covering the wall melts and makes the wall moist. Especially modern houses which don't have eaves. So having a timber finishing, it is a good idea to make a higher plinth. With the beam foundation you can choose the depth and the height of the foundation, but with slab foundation you can't play that much with them. Today we have got concrete and steel. When rebar is used properly, we can build this. Wider footing makes the foundation more stable, narrower walls help to reduce material waste. Also, it is easier to mount insulation and install cables and pipes. Because of rebar, this beam foundation is monolithic and stiff. Rebars located here and here are very important. If there will be uneven subsidence, then rebar tries to make it smooth. For example, this is a straight foundation wall. Imagine that for some reason here is softer soil. So this part of the foundation starts to sink. This rebar responds to traction and tries to hold the stress. And by that gives more pressure here and here. Or maybe here is softer soil. So this upper rebar tries to hold the traction and keep the foundation monolithic. So these rebars are very important and anything less than 12 mm is weak. The wider this part is, the better it can deal with pressure. Now I am going to explain to you how a proper beam foundation is built. Before the foundation works, you need to know how and when communication works take place. After sorting it out, you need to dig a ditch. Make it a bit wider so it is easier to work and dirt from walls don't disturb you. Now the following information is very important. When you start to level the bottom of the ditch, then you can remove excess with the shovel, but you can't fill this area with the same soil. It will sink over time, since nature has packed soil very well and messing with that makes it fluffy. So you need to fill this pit with stones and vibrate them. Then add about 10 cm stones everywhere and vibrate them again. So stones start to push into the ground, adding some extra strength for the foundation. Now it is time for a footing. There are many products on the market which make this work easier. Don't buy them. For example, this footing form. The problem is that rebar needs about 3 cm protective layer in concrete. When steel gets together with water and air, the chemical reaction starts, which generates rust, and rust expands, cracking the concrete. Also, this inner rebar is too small. Similar story with these expanded clay footing blocks. A protective layer is too small, plus rebar needs to be located here, not here. For proper footing, use trusses to make a form. Depends on the project, but usually they are about 20 to 30 cm high and 60 to 80 cm wide. This is the place where you don't save a big fortune, so don't be stingy with concrete and rebar. After creating a form, it is time for a reinforcement. A common mistake is in the corners. Remember, the inner rebar needs to be tied with the outer. Not like so, but... like so. Then you pour the right crush of concrete and the footing is basically ready. After a few days you can remove forms and start to lay blocks. Hollow concrete blocks are the strongest, since you can make there a proper reinforcement. Make sure that you have here up some heavy rebars. When the foundation wall is ready, you need to install here up bitumen to stop water from moving into the walls. If you have a one-story house, then here you don't need to mount bitumen. So you can install insulation, plaster it and fill the ditch with sand. You need to remove all the organic soil from the inside and replace it with sand or rocks. Filling a hole, it is very important to do it by 10 to 20 cm layers. Each layer needs to be moistened and vibrated. This is tremendous work, that is why most builders fill the whole hole with sand and vibrate only once. This way, sand here up is tight, but here below soft and has air in it. With time it settles and the floor moves down, ruining interior finishing. So negotiate that part with builders and be ready to pay some extra money for that work. Quality is pricey. As you see from that video, water seeps up. This is called capillary moisture. The same happens with sand. You need to stop the water. Otherwise, the foam insulation sucks it in and loses its properties. The cheapest way is to lay the film on the sand. It should work for some time. I suggest to use a thick film and lay it in two rows. Also, mount here bitumen so your house is protected from the capillary moisture. The second, more expensive method is to use a layer of stones. As you have seen from this video, materials with air pockets in them are good against capillary moisture. Same story with rocks, water does not move up through the air. But it is difficult to lay foam sheets on the rocky surface. That's why some workers make the next mistake. They add a small layer of sand on the top of the stones, so they can easily level the floor. Smaller fractions do fill these air pockets, and the mission to cut capillary moisture is failed. Also, the floor will settle because of that. The best way is to pour a 5 cm concrete plate on top of stones and install bitumen on that. Now your floor is properly protected from moisture. Quality is pricey. Many workers don't use hydrostop at all. They say that film needs to mount on the foam sheets. Because this way concrete dries longer and you have more time to work with the fresh concrete. I suggest you find workers who can work with concrete poured on the EPS. The film or the bitumen layer needs to be located below the insulation. Even the producers confirm that EPS absorbs the water. For example, this wall has that problem. Materials tend to expand when their humidity level rises. Freshly fabricated EPS shrinks in the first 3 months. This is the reason why there are gaps between mounted sheets very often. I suggest you buy an EPS a few months before the installation. Unpack them so they can shrink. After insulation, it is time for reinforcement and plumbing works. Now you can fill them in with 8 to 10 cm thick concrete. Wonderful! Now you know how strong and long-lasting beam foundation and the floor are built. What else do you want to know about in my future videos? Leave a comment. I am a big smartass, so I know a lot.